صلى الله عليه وسلم علي ابن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. And we talk about the fada'il of Ali. And we don't need to repeat it again over and over. And we said, it's enough for Ali to know that he was raised in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By Rasulullah and Khadija radiallahu anha, married Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha. His kids were al-Hassan and al-Hussein radiallahu anhum, participated in the major battles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the hero of Badr in Uhud, in Ahzab, in Khaybar, and so many. But a question that may be raised, why do you think among all the Sahaba of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only about Ali radiallahu anhu ardah, there is this confusion? And why the group of Shia only talks about Ali that he was killed or people were unjust to him? Umar radiallahu anhu also was shaheed in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Uthman radiallahu anhu also was shaheed inside his house. Why do you think only Ali radiallahu anhu? What do you think? Any idea? Coincidence? Something else? Yes, but this is actually what Rasulullah said, and that's true. We talk about it also. But why a group of people only, they have so much passion for Ali than any other of the Sahaba of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We said if he was shaheed, they were also shaheed. If they were related to Rasulullah, they were also related to Rasulullah. If he married Fatima al-Zahra, Uthman married Ummu Kulsum and Ruqayya. What do you think? You never ask yourself this question? No? Yes? Because the grandsons of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein. Okay, let's put it this way now. The main issue is they claim that Ali radiallahu anhu arda deserve to be the Khalifa, not Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman. This is the whole idea, the whole idea of Imama, which is the whole Shiism is based on. Now we're going to just put a question. Either Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did make a wasiyah and he said openly, after I die, Ali is supposed to be the Khalifa. Or he did not say that. There's no third one. Either he said it clearly or he didn't say it. If we say it that he did say, we are going to say that all the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I'm sorry to say, including Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everybody failed. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for 23 years of his teaching, could not educate his Sahaba that they will carry the haqq and they will implement the haqq after he passed away. All of them, 100,000 people or more. Or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't say anything, and that's what we believe in. Now we're going to take again that idea that he said. If he said it, right? Ali radiallahu anhu arda, he heard that or he didn't hear? We're going to again put the same question. He heard or he didn't hear? If he didn't hear, okay, we have no question. Now if he heard that, so Rasulullah sallallahu told him, you are the one who's supposed to be the Khalifa after me. Now after Rasulullah sallallahu passed away, what happened to Ali? He did not execute the order. He failed. Oh, you say because didn't let him do that. Again, he failed. In any sense, we are actually accusing Ali radiallahu anhu arda more than accusing anyone else. Now look at the proper way. Ali radiallahu anhu arda, after the departure of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was actually praying every day, every month, every year, participating in the battles behind Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Why he was doing that? It was just because he was nice? Or actually he believed that Abu Bakr is the Khalifa and he is following the Khalifa. Now Abu Bakr passed away. So again the same story will be happening. Umar, Ali radiallahu anhu arda, was again among the closest advisors of Umar radiallahu anhu arda. And probably in the time of Abu Bakr was very short, 2 years and 2 months. And the Muslims were actually busy with a lot of things. A lot of people rejected Islam, a lot of people refused to give zakat, a lot of people claimed to be prophets like Musaylim al-Kaddab, like al-Aswad al-Ansi, like Sajah. So they were very busy. But the time of Umar, it's 10 years. 10 years, Ali radiallahu anhu arda was the closest advisor to Umar, who was praying behind Umar, who was actually giving advices to Umar. And he will join him in Hajj, in Umrah. And Ali was quiet. He was just too nice, that's why. We do have a little of brains that we could think about. Ali was among the people of Umar. Umar radiallahu anhu arda, again, 10 years, was killed. But before that, he said, 6 people will be one of them after me. And the Muslims choose 2 of them, right? Actually, he said either Ali or Uthman or Abdurrahman ibn Auf or Talha or Zubayr or Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. And now, most of the people say we're not interested except Ali and Uthman. So it was between both of them. Finally, it was actually almost equal, and then they choose Uthman radiallahu anhu for many reasons. One of them that he was older than Ali radiallahu anhu. And again, Ali was among the helper, the advisors in the army of Uthman. And so you're going to say, well, what happened to Ali? He was just being nice and he had to let it go. Okay, if we take it that way, okay, let it go. If Ali himself accepted that, do we love Ali more than he loves himself? Do we understand the Khilafah and the Imamah more than Ali radiallahu anhu arda? Definitely not. Now, in the time of Ali, on the time of Uthman, the main defender who used to defend Uthman more than anyone else, it was Ali radiallahu anhu arda. When the rebellions in the end of the life of Uthman came to Medina and he had arguments with Uthman radiallahu anhu, guess who actually was talking to them? Guess who Uthman chose to send to them to talk to them? No one but Ali radiallahu anhu, Abu al-Hasan. He chose him, he said, okay, you are the one who's going to talk to them. You are the one who's going to argue with them. You are the one who's going to convince them. And he was able to convince them. Because they accused Uthman radiallahu anhu with many things. They said to him, oh, you're choosing only the people who are from your family. Oh, you burned the Quran and you choose only one copy. You did. And Ali was in charge to go and talk to them and convince them that all what Uthman did was right. Was defending him. Ali radiallahu anhu arda. In the end of the day, let me put it again from the beginning. Do you think Ali radiallahu anhu was like me and you? Do you think he had this hub of dunya like me and you? Do you think he had this hub of being the Khalifa like me or you? These are the people who their concern was akhirah, was not dunya at all. That's his life. But if you're telling me that Ali all the time was only thinking that he's supposed to be but not Abu Bakr, he's supposed to be not Umar, he's supposed to be not Uthman, you are telling me, وحاشا لله, that Ali all his time, he was just thinking about himself. That he was just after the dunya, not after the akhirah. And Ali completely was not there. Actually, even when they came to give him the bay'ah, he said, يا دنيا غري غيري. He said, oh dunya, you could seduce someone else, but not me. Because he's actually the one who was raised in the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, the biggest story, we're going to bring it again, we talked about it last week, but we're going to finish it. It's something that in all the books of Shia is called Hadithu al-Ghadir. Hadith al-Ghadir or Hadith of Ghadir Khum. In every book of Shia, they cry, they have Husayniyah, then they cry, Hadith of Ghadir, Hadith of Ghadir, Hadith of Ghadir. And what is that exactly? Anybody knows the circumstances of this? Okay. I'm going to say something that probably you never going to see or read or hear from any book of Shia, although it's in their books also. What happened exactly in Hadith al-Ghadir? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went for Hajj. Fine? When did he go for Hajj? What year was that? The last year of his life. Meaning anything before, there was no such thing. So the incident of Hadith al-Ghadir is going to happen when? Just few months before Rasulullah passed away. Rasulullah made Hajj actually in Dhul Hijjah, and he passed away in Rabi'ul Awwal. Dhul Hijjah, right? Muharram, Safar, Rabi'ul Awwal, 82, 83 days, and Rasulullah passed away. Rasulullah, when he was going, what he did? He asked Ali to join him, but first he's supposed to go to Yemen. Ali was being sent to Yemen to collect what? Zakat, called fay', from all the Yemeni people, and he's supposed to bring it and join Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Good. Ali radiallahu anhu went and he did the job and he collected the fay', the money, the gold, whatever is needed. When he collected everything, he's supposed to divide it according to the Sharia. The Sharia says that whatever you are collecting, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ have said, ayah of the khumus, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَصُولِهِ خُمُسُ. What's the ayah? You review it. Going back. The ayah, what it says, whatever you collect, khumus, the one, the 25% or 20%, 20% supposed to go to who? To Allah and His Rasul. That's how it is. That's how it is. Ali took that khumus and he said, this is for Rasulullah. Among the khumus of this, Ali took one female servant for himself. And the Sahaba didn't like it. They disagree with him. They said, no, it's not for you. First, it has to go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the ayah says it's for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they had arguments with him. Which is that possible? That's possible. That's fine. That's fine. Ali right now came, subhanAllah, to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to join him. Some of the Sahaba, they went to Rasulullah. And they complained to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, this is what Ali did. And again, another one did. Another. Rasulullah, whenever someone complained to him about Ali, he doesn't even respond to him. Probably he turns his face away from him. The Hajj finished. And the time of Hajj finished. And Rasulullah now is what? Going back. Back where? Home, back to Medina. Until they stop to a place called Ghadir Khum. What's Ghadir means? Water. River. The Ghadir in Arabic language is like a small river until they got there. Again, people were asking him about Ali and what he did. So there, Rasulullah stopped and then he called Ali. He said, I heard what the people saying about you. They are complaining about you. They are saying. And then he turned to everybody and he said that I agree with what Ali said and I agree with what Ali did. وَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَاهُ فَإِنَّ عَلِيُّ الْمَوْلَاهُ. Meaning, if you are claiming that you love me, then you're supposed to love Ali. And if you agree with me, you're supposed to agree with Ali. This is actually the circumstances of what? Of the hadith of Ghadir of Khum. Now this ayah, this word, this hadith, this saying, does it say that Ali is supposed to be the Khalifa? Now let's say if someone wants to say yes. If someone wants to say Rasulullah, he got the information from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell the people that he, Ali, is the one. He's gonna wait until he was going back, and now how many people are left with him? There are only a few. Because in the time of Hajj, everybody is with him in Hajj. In the last Hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 120,000 Sahabi and Sahabiya attended that. So if it really there's a balagh, there's a that Rasulullah has to convey a message, he's supposed to convey it when? When everybody is there. So they would know that. Now if only a few people left, that's not the proper way. And then Rasulullah said about Ali, oh Ali, and he told him that, Wallahi, لا يحبك إلا مؤمن ولا يكرهك إلا منافق. Whoever loves you, indeed that's a sign of Iman. And whoever doesn't like you, indeed it's a sign of hypocrisy. It's a sign of nifaq. We, Ahlul Sunnah, we believe in that? Yes, we believe in that. That's Rasulullah said that? Yes, Rasulullah said that. But that does not mean, in any sense. Now another thing which is very important. I said there were a few Sahabas there. 100, 200, 500, 1,000, 2,000, whatever you want, 1,800. So all those Sahaba heard this hadith from Rasulullah when he was coming from Hajj, and they heard that, and only after 83 days Rasulullah passed away, and those Sahaba, all of them did what? They hide it, or they said we don't remember, or they decline it, or it's actually an accusation to the entire. Do you know what's the result of this? The result of this, and I'm telling you again, the result of this, if we accuse that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum heard this hadith and they understood this hadith, and Rasulullah indicate that Ali is the supposed to be the Khalifa, and all of them, they hide the truth, it means a very clear thing that we should not trust the Sahaba. And if we don't trust the Sahaba, we cannot trust this Quran. Do you know why? Do you know why, brothers? Why? I get this Quran from who? From the Sahaba. I get this Quran not from Allah, from the Sahaba. I don't talk to Allah. I don't talk to Jibreel. I never saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? They are the one heard Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they convey this message. So if I doubt them, I'm going to doubt this one. If I doubt their intention, I'm going to doubt this one. And that's exactly what is meant to. It meant to accuse this Quran. And once this book is being accused, or the carrier of this book are being accused, the whole deen will collapse. Because look, if they come to you and they say, we have doubt about the Quran, you're not going to even talk to them. What are you talking about? I'm not going to talk to you. You'll get out of my face. But if I said, no, I believe in the Quran that you're saying, but the people who actually related this Quran to you, related this Quran to you, these are the ones that I doubt. That's the sneaky way how they want to do it. That's exactly what happened. Ali radiallahu anhu arda lived all his life. I'm sorry, I'm going to take an extra 2 minutes. Ali radiallahu anhu arda, there's a very famous book called, which is all the Shia believes in. It's called Nahjul Balagha. Nahjul Balagha, it's a collection of what? Of all the khutab of Ali radiallahu anhu arda. Some of them are authentic, some they're not authentic. But this book is being studied by the Shia and the Sunni. The Mufassir of the Shia is called Ibn Abi al-Hadid. The Mufassir of this book of the Sunni is Muhammad Abdu. And each one of them has the explanation of those khutab of Ali radiallahu anhu. I was a man of literature, so it was a part of our studies that we do have to study also Nahj al-Balagha. A part of Nahj al-Balagha, which is narrated also by the Shi'is and the Sunnis together. This is what he said. لما قدم علي رضي الله عنه البصرة. When Ali came to the Basra, So when he came, they asked him, please listen to these words. They asked him, ألا تخبرنا عن مسيرك هذا الذي سرت فيه تتولى على الأمة تضرب بعضهم ببعض أعهد من رسول الله عهده إليك. They told him, you coming from Medina and coming to the Basra, and now you created this chaos between the Muslims. Is it because Rasulullah, he give you a ahd, he give you a promise that you're supposed to be the Khalifa, or it's just from your own? فحددنا فأنت الموثوق المأمون على ما سمعت. They said, you tell us, we trust you, we believe you. فقال, أما أن يكون عندي عهد من النبي. Number one, if you are telling me that this is ahd, this is an oath, this is a promise from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فلا والله, definitely it's not. إن كنت أول من صدق به فلا أكون أول من كذب عليه. Subhanallah, beautiful verse. He said, if I was the first one to believe in him, how can I be the first one to lie on his behalf? Such a beautiful way. He was the first one to accept him. So how can he be the first one to lie on his behalf? And look what he said again. وَلَوْ كَانَ عِنْدِي مِنَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَهْدٌ فِي ذَلِكَ مَا تَرَكْتُ أَخَى بَنِي تَيْمِ بْنِ مُرَّةِ. He said, and if I had a word, a promise from Rasulullah صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ regarding this matter, I would never give it to Abu Bakr Siddiq. Make sense? Make sense. He said, if Rasulullah told me that I'm supposed to be, why should I leave it to Abu Bakr? And then he repeated the same. And he said, if I had that, I would not let Umar, I would not let Uthman, subhanAllah. But what he said, ما تركت أخا بني تيم بن مرة وعمر بن الخطاب يقومان على منبره. I would not let Abu Bakr and Umar to stand on his manbar because they will become the Khalifa. وَلَا قَاتَلْتُهُمَا بِيَدِي وَلَوْ لَمْ أَجِدْ إِلَّا بُرْدِي هَذَا. And I will fight them with my own hands even if I don't find anything, because that's a ahd from Rasulullah and I'm supposed to fulfill that ahd, subhanAllah. But look what he said. وَلَكِنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَمْ يُقْتَلْ. Such a logical way. He said, but indeed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not killed. وَلَمْ يَمُتْ فَجْأَةً. He didn't die all of a sudden. مَكَتَ فِي مَرَضِهِ أَيَّامًا. He was sick for a few days. يَأْتِيهِ الْمُؤَدِّنُ. Every day the Mu'addin will come to him. فَيَأْمُرُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ أَنْ يُصَلِّي بِالنَّاسِ. There's no beautiful, no better logic than this. He said Rasulullah was sick for so many days, maybe 10 days. And every day the Mu'addin will come to him. And he will come to make the adhan. And he will tell the Mu'addin, go tell Abu Bakr to lead the people. First day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, seventh day, eighth day, ninth. Never ever he told him, tell Ali to lead the people. Or anyone else to lead the people. So if there was something, why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't tell me, Ali, go and lead the prayer even one time? One duhr, one asr, one maghrib, one isha, one fajr, one jumu'ah, one something? Is there a better logic than this? And actually, who's saying this? And I'm going to stop over here. Who's saying this? Ali radiallahu anhu arda. And after all that, what we do, we accuse the Sahaba, the best of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah to forgive me and forgive all of us. Astaghfirullah from jami'an. Yes. Very good question. So, we know from the zakat that the zakat is supposed to be 2.5%. For what? For the money or for the gold. But of course, you know, in business is something different. For example, if you have a farm, depends it's on the rain or not on the rain. So it's not 2.5%, it's not 5%, it goes by 10%, by whatever. So each category is something. But the ayah that talks about the zakat, it says for Allah and His Rasul, it's why khumus. In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever there was any battle, Rasulullah, he took for himself, which is given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much? The khumus. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, there's no such thing. It was given to who? to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If someone's still claiming that, we're going to tell him you're not Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we're going to give that khumus to who? Someone who's representing Rasulullah? No, there's no such thing. And you're going to tell me you're going to give it to the family of Rasulullah? We're going to tell you Rasulullah said his family, they don't take zakat and they don't take sadaqah. He say we the family of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's not allowed for them to take zakat. It's not allowed for them to take sadaqah. But you honor them by gifts, by hiba, by something else. Because how you claim that's the descendant of your beloved one and then you give him sadaqah. It's like he's lower than you. One of the hadith says, إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ أَوْسَاخُ النَّاسِ. Indeed, the sadaqah is like the dirt of the people. What do you mean by the dirt? Whenever someone does something bad, you say, I'm giving sadaqah to, you know, to remove my sayyah. That's what you're going to put in the hand of the descendant of your beloved one, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why when Rasulullah saw his grandson Al-Hasan, one time he took one date from the date of sadaqah, he went to him and he say, like the, and then he opened his mouth and he removed it from his mouth. We know how Rasulullah was so nice and so soft and so kind and so, even when he was riding him during the prayer, Rasulullah didn't move and he let him play. And when he, Rasulullah was in the khutbah and he saw the Hassan walking and he fell down, he left the khutbah and he went and he carried him and he said, Subhanallah, innama amwalukum wa awladukum fitna. But when he saw him eating one piece of date, I let him eat it. No. He said, we, the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we don't eat the sadaqah. Allah forgive all of us again. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Yes. The hadith of Khumus or the hadith of Ghadir? Hadith of Ghadir? Hadith of Ghadir is sahih. Yeah, it's sahih. Maybe you're not going to find it in Bukhari or Muslim, but you're going to find it in some other books of sahih. And the versions are fair. And recently, probably you know the Muhaddith of Asr, Imam al-Albani rahimahullah, he put the intensity of this hadith that the hadith is sahih. So we do feel it sahih. Okay, there's one great scholars who disagree with that, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He disagree with this hadith and say it's not sahih in his book, Minhaj al-Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah. But most of the scholars, they agree that this hadith is sahih. And,